I'm director, medical director of Peninsula Behavioral Health in December of 2010. Dr. George Jones was born in White Salmon, and that's in eastern Washington, if you don't know. Raised in Kelso, graduated with the University of Puget Sound and the University of Washington School of Medicine. He's board certified as a diplomat of the American Board of Psychiatric and Neurology and General and Forensic Psychiatry. In 2008, he served as attending psychiatrist to the U.S. Army's 1835th Medical Detachment in Camp Iraq. How about just Iraq? Previously, Dr. Jones is medical director of the Alexander Assessment and Treatment Group in Rochester, New York. Dr. Jones is a clinical instructor in the University of Washington Family Medicine Department and clinical assistant professor of psychiatry at the University of Rochester School of Medicine and Dentistry. Dr. Jones's duties include supervising PBH's psychiatric treatment services, performing forensic psychiatric evaluations, and coordinating services under Peninsula Behavioral Health's contract with the hospital district to provide bedside psychiatric consultations. In addition, Saturday was his 40th birthday.
Oh, 40th birthday party. The 40th birthday is until next month.
Okay, his 40th birthday party. See, I never get anything totally correct. And in addition to that, he's a friend of mine. And welcome, Josh, and thank you so much for coming.
Well, thank you, and I'm really, really pleased to be here. Really pleased to address all of you. This isn't working for me here, so I'm just going to take this out of here. Really pleased to address all of you here today. Many familiar faces, and those of you who I haven't met, I hope to do so soon. So I am the medical director at Peninsula Behavioral Health. We changed our name to Peninsula Behavioral Health from Peninsula Community Mental Health Center about 3 years ago to reflect a change in the philosophy of how mental health services are delivered, both from a scientific philosophical standpoint and also from a governmental payer standpoint. The difference is this, and I'll get more into this a little bit later. Behavioral health encompasses both mental health and chemical dependency treatment. As I'm sure most of you know, a lot of those issues co-occur in the same individual. And so up until the last few years, three areas of healthcare were delivered pretty separately. You had your non-psychiatric physical health that you'd go to your primary care provider for, to your GP, your general clinic. You had your mental health, which may be delivered by a mental health center or a therapist or a psychiatrist or a psychologist. And then you had your chemical dependency treatment, which would be delivered by chemical dependency treatment providers. Because of the Affordable Health Care Act and health care reform, there's been a really exciting change in how we've been thinking about these. And whether you're for or against the health care reform, I think we can all agree, at least it's been exciting, the changes that have occurred. And so Washington State has decided that we're going to try to integrate all three of these spheres into one stream of how these treatments are funded and monitored and communicate, hopefully, to produce better results. So by 2016, mental health and chemical dependency are supposed to be integrated into behavioral health services. And then by 2020, behavioral health services and primary care are supposed to be integrated. That was a very long preamble to explain why our name changed, but it's also very important information for you guys to have as business owners. When I was thinking about coming and speaking to you today, I was trying to think about how to explain to just any passerby why the business association should be interested in finding out more about behavioral health. And I came up with three reasons. The first is, as I'm sure you all know, I mean, you know, as I'm sure you guys all believe, you know, good business owners are good community members. If you have a healthy community, then you have people who are productive. who can, you know, then come and be clients of your business. And so a healthy community fosters healthy businesses and vice versa. So that's probably the obvious one. Then the two other reasons that I think are very important for you guys are what I'm going to call the noisy reason and the quiet reason. And I think you guys all know about the noisy reason. The noisy reason why you should be interested in behavioral health is because sometimes people with behavioral health issues can cause disruptions in the community, can cause disruptions in your business. You know, whether it's because their behavior is impacting you specifically inside your business, or you know, whether it's you know, people on the street who you know are panhandling, some of whom have mental illness and some who don't. Those can be quite disruptive to the community and quite disruptive to your individual businesses. The second reason, the quiet reason, is one that I don't think we pay enough attention to. And I call it quiet because it's not the thing that gathers headlines, it's not the thing that, you know, that the police get called about. But, and anybody who's heard me speak in the community before has probably heard me say this, that the number one medical cause for lost work days in the working age population worldwide, and it's not even close, the number one reason for missed work days is depression. Depression saps your workers of their ability to work. And that's the number one medical reason for missed work days worldwide. I don't have specific numbers for Clallam County, but any place that's been studied, that's been found to be true. So what that means to me is, and you probably, you know, it may be quiet because a lot of people don't say I'm taking a sick day for depression. That's just not something we say, right? There's lots of other reasons. But for any business owner who has had an employee or a friend of an employee or a relative of an employee commit suicide, usually because of depression, it has a massive interruption in everybody's, you know, in everybody's lives. It's one of the biggest tragedies that there is, and so that's another reason for you guys to be interested in behavioral health. So, what I'd like to do is I'd like to describe for you kind of how behavioral health is delivered in the county, and what changes have occurred over the last few years, at least over the last 5 years since I've been here, and what challenges there still are to overcome. The integration of mental health care and chemical dependency and behavior and primary care is underway. When I first got here in 2010, it was not unusual for Olympic Medical Center and primary care providers and Peninsula Behavioral Health and the chemical dependency treatment providers to have very little communication with each other about how their clients, about how their patients are doing. And that's changed and is continuing to change for a variety of reasons. Peninsula Behavioral Health, and we're the largest provider of behavioral health services in the county. We have over 100 employees. Unfortunately, we only have one full-time psychiatrist, myself, and then we've got several nurse practitioners, many, many therapists who are licensed clinical social workers, licensed mental health counselors, licensed marriage and family therapists, and then we have a couple chemical dependency treatment providers. We've been able to partner with Olympic Medical Center and Olympic Medical Physicians to provide inpatient consultations, to psychiatric consultations to people who are hospitalized for medical or surgical problems. We currently have an agreement with Olympic Medical Physicians where we have a prescribing nurse practitioner in their clinics helping to provide behavioral health care right there in the primary care setting. One of the reasons why that's so important to have behavioral health providers right in the primary care setting is because when I talked about kind of the quiet problem, one of the biggest issues that we have in treating behavioral health problems is that they don't come to the attention of clinicians sometimes until it's too late. About 50% of the suicides that occur nationwide occur for people who are not involved in mental health care, or not involved in behavioral health care. We find that to be true here. Fortunately, we don't have, you know, a lot of suicides in Clallam County. We do have a high rate compared to the rest of the state, but you know, it's still a relatively rare event, thank goodness. But of the people that we have to psychiatrically hospitalize against their will, Peninsula Behavioral Health and other treatment providers have only met about 50% of them. So the early identification of any disease, whether it's diabetes or pneumonia or depression or another behavioral health condition, leads to earlier treatment, better care, and avoiding these really bad outcomes. So having behavioral health care right in the primary care setting helps identify people earlier and helps break that stigma. Because I don't know if anybody's ever, I mean, what, you know, I know Grant has, I know Edna has, I know lots of people have walked into our lobby at Peninsula Behavioral Health. For whatever your reason is, sometimes it's difficult to get people in that front door. It just is. And I wish it wasn't that way. I wish the stigma wasn't there, but it is. We're breaking that down, but it's still there. So if we can catch people in an environment which they're comfortable in, such as their primary care provider's office, we can help them. And one of the things that we're doing now, both at Olympic Medical Physicians, and we've just partnered with Family Medicine of Port Angeles, which I understand as of September 1st is going to become the North Olympic Healthcare Network, because they, at great personal cost actually to the physicians who were there, they've decided to step up and transition their private practice into a federally qualified health center, which allows them special funding to treat anybody, to treat indigent folks, to treat anybody who comes through their doors. So, that's a huge boon for our community. We're partnering with them to put a licensed clinical social worker in their office full time, so that when a primary care provider, when your doc sees, you know, this person's got some depression issues, I'm going to treat their diabetes right now, then I'm going to step out of the room and have this trained behavioral health specialist come in, talk to them for a while, assess exactly what's going on, because it's not the primary care provider's specialty to do so. And then they'll step out and tell the primary care doc, here's what I think's going on, here's what I'm going to do about it. If you want, I suggest you prescribe a medication, and we'll do this together. Together, the primary care doc, the behavioral health specialist, and the patient themselves, right there in the primary care setting. And this is really exciting, and I mean that in a very positive way, because it's been shown through University of Washington study after University of Washington study that this is a very effective way to treat both depression, other mental health conditions, but also it helps improve physical health, which is a great boon for the community. So the integration of behavioral and primary health care is happening there. The integration of chemical dependency and mental health is also occurring. There are several chemical dependency treatment providers. Most of them are looking to partner and how better to provide the behavioral health services so that people can get both their mental health and their chemical dependency issues treated at the same time. We used to think, by we I meaning the scientific community, that you needed to either treat the mental health condition first and then you can tackle chemical dependency, or you got to treat the chemical dependency piece first and then you can tackle the mental health issues. It's been shown over the past 20 years that that's really ineffective, and you know, it's kind of intuitive that one set of problems leads into the other. So tackling both at the same time is complex, it's difficult to do, but it's the right thing to do and it produces better outcomes. So those things are occurring as well. other successes that have occurred in the county over the past few years is that there has been a increased push to get mental health services in the jail to try to break the cycle of offense, release, reoffense. Trying to hook people up with resources, not to excuse the crimes that they've done, not to say, oh, you shouldn't, you know, pay the price for the offense that you've committed, but to try to give them resources that they can access, that they can work towards to prevent the cycle of reoffense. And we have had some early results. One of the other successes that I'll give great credit to the government of Clown County for helping create is the Clown County Respite Center, which is a 6-bed voluntary hospital diversion unit that's located on Peninsula Behavioral Health's campus up on 8th Street. And what this allows us to do is for people who are non-dangerous, but who are having a behavioral health crisis, instead of going to the emergency department and clogging up OMC's resources, instead of having to be involuntarily detained under Washington state law and sent to a psychiatric hospital, if they can, they can come there for a few days, speak with counselors, remove themselves from whatever situation has usually precipitated the crisis, have their medications readjusted if that's needed, and then go right and then re-enter their lives, re-enter society right from there, as opposed to having a very disruptive psychiatric hospitalization. Because, as I'm sure most of you know, we have no psychiatric hospital in Clown County. The closest one is in Silverdale, which is often very disruptive to people's lives. And the goal, of course, is to get people stable and get them back to their lives so that many of them can be productive members of society. And as I'm thinking about what to talk to you guys about here, I realize that the successes that the county has had over the past few years are really, I mean, there's a lot, but they're kind of invisible. I mean, I think, you know, I heard a colleague of mine was in Iraq said that, you know, mental health is kind of like, it's kind of like the CIA, stick with me here, in that our successes are many, but really invisible, but the failures are few but obvious. So we've had a lot of successes. The county has been wonderful in terms of, you know, viewing behavioral health crises as a public health issue. I think that's only going to continue. As of September 1st, there's going to be a new public health officer, Dr. Chris Frank, who is a good colleague of mine. He's very friendly towards behavioral health and viewing that as just one piece of a healthy community. So I think that is going to be another great success for our county. Let me shift now to a few of the challenges that we face and will continue to face. I think the biggest, one of the biggest challenges that our county faces is access to care. And this is by no means limited to behavioral health care. I'm sure you've all heard that we have an absolute shortage of primary care physicians. Many of the primary care clinics in the county have shut their roles to taking on new patients. I don't know if you're all aware of that or not, but Jamestown Clinic, Olympic Medical Physicians, and Family Medicine have at one time or another the past 2 years just shut their doors, said we can't take any more patients because we don't have the providers, we don't have the docs or the PAs or the nurse practitioners to see them safely. So that's been an issue there. It continues to be an issue with behavioral health care as well. I am the only full-time psychiatrist at Peninsula Behavioral Health. We have one other one, Dr. Winternitz, who's there for only 5 hours a week, and she's got a very small private practice. And I know the other couple psychiatrists who are practicing privately have limited hours as well. So availability of behavioral health care services is, it's difficult to meet the need. PBH does not, we don't turn anybody away, and we struggle but succeed in other chemical dependency treatment providers and other private behavioral health treatment providers in the county. They'll tell you the same thing. Access to care is difficult. It's better than it was, certainly when I came here 5 years ago. But the number of people who are seeking care, it has increased dramatically with Medicaid expansion due to the Affordable Care Act. I think that is, again, whether or not you like the politics behind it or not, I think the people accessing care is a good thing because we're catching them earlier, at least, before it's become a crisis that will result in hospitalization or potential death. Another challenge that we're facing is, I think the growth of some serious chemical dependency issues in the county, and they've been here for a long time. I mean, I know everybody knows that, you know, methamphetamine use has long been what you can consider an epidemic. Heroin use is on the rise, on the dramatic rise, not just in Clallam County, but in Washington State. There are theories as to why that is, but you know, we don't have a coordinated treatment program for opiate addiction, and heroin is an opiate along with many prescribed opiates such as oxycodone and things like that. There are effective treatments for it. We don't have a clinic like that. I'm sure you've all heard of like a methadone clinic in some of the bigger cities. Those are still effective, but there are other medications that are much safer to use, including one that's an injectable, a long-acting injectable that actually blocks the action of the opioid and is highly effective. We don't have a coordinated clinic or a coordinated way to deliver that to our residents of Clallam County who struggle with opiate addiction. I think that's a real shame, and I think it's a public health issue that we need to figure out what to do about that. I know, I'm sure that you guys are going to have questions. I want to leave plenty of time for that. I know it's past 8 o'clock. So at that point, you know, let me say, I think that, you know, if you're outside the behavioral health world looking in on it, you do see the kind of the failures of the system. And it's easy for me to say, you know, don't worry, we're having a lot more successes than failures. But you know, it's a process, it's a struggle. A lot of people who have behavioral and chemical dependency issues, they don't want help. Or some of them don't even know that they need help. And that can be a challenge too, but that's the minority. And the vast majority of people with behavioral health issues in Clallam County are like us. They're working, they're living productive lives, they're married, they have children, and they've got a brain disease, because that's what behavioral health conditions are. They're diseases of the brain. And our science hasn't caught up with the rest of the medical profession to tell us exactly why these things are happening. But, you know, they're diseases of the brain, and we're doing our best to treat them. So with that being said, I'd be glad to answer any questions that you guys have. It's really wide open, and I'm sure I know what two of them are going to be right off the bat. But that's fine. Well, you can. I'm glad to answer. I'll just get it out there. So let me answer the question about busing. I'm sure people have heard it. You know, there's hordes of mentally ill and chemical dependent people who get bused to our community because we have better resources than Seattle. I've heard that. I've also heard that in every other community I've practiced in. I've heard that in Rochester, New York. I heard that in Burlington, Vermont. I didn't hear that in Iraq. actually, I did hear that. Now that I think about it, I did hear that in Iraq. The base that I was at had a clinic, and we would get the soldiers brought in. So I did hear that. It's not true. There's no evidence to suggest that that's actually happening. What you will see is I think that our community, at least, and the communities I've practiced in, are kind of magnets for strangeness, which is really good in some way. I mean, I honestly think, and I've said this publicly before, and I'll say it again, I think that there were more people who were attracted to the Port Angeles area because of Twilight than were are bused here, you know, because
yeah,
we have too many
cities. Yeah, but that's a fun addiction. It's really a
well,
fun addiction.
Well, is it though, Sherry?
Yes.
Is it?
So,
but you know, well, I'm right there with you. So, it's just not true. I mean, it is true that we sometimes, and this doesn't happen very often, I think maybe once every other year or so, we will get called from like the state hospital, PBH will get called from the state hospital and go, look, we've got a guy who's burned every bridge, we need a place for him to go, you're it. And it, you know, that happens, but I haven't seen any evidence that there's, you know, busloads of folks that get bused here because we've got better resources. A, we don't have better resources or more resources than the urban areas in I-5. That's just not true. And so, I mean, I just don't think there's evidence for that. There's definitely, you know, we do have a homeless problem, but every place has a homeless problem as well. We're a poorer county than those in the I-5 corridor. That, you know, that breeds homelessness and it coexists with an increase in behavioral health conditions. So, you know, that's what I have to say about that.
George.
Yeah, George.
Without trying to reduce this important issue to a number, how many clients a year do you see? And
oh, that's a great question. So, so Peninsula Behavioral Health saw over 4,000 people last year. This year's numbers, we're about to exceed that already. If we haven't already, we may have exceeded that already. So about 4,000 individual 4,000 unique patients were contacted last year. Any breakouts of that population that are of interest to you? Do you have anything in mind? Sure, sure. And I don't have the number. I don't have those numbers off the top of my head. We do have a contract with the VA to provide veteran services. The VA clinic in town here has their own behavioral health treatment providers. They don't have enough of them, so we have a contract to provide. Provide some of those as well. Robert Perry, who's a licensed clinical social worker, is our main guy on that. I don't know the number of veterans that we've served. Our chemical dependency folks that we see are in a group that's known as co-occurring disorders, so they have a behavioral health condition as well as chemical dependency. And again, I just don't have the numbers off the top of my head on that. That not as many as I would like to serve this year, unfortunately, and that's simply a factor of, you know, not being able to identify them and bring them into services. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Do you have any knowledge of the Thurston County Veterans Court, District Court? Have some knowledge. It was founded and started by
You know, I'm almost sure that there has been. I have not been privy to any of those. I am familiar with the Veterans Court with the Veterans Court concept. I'm not familiar with Thurston Courts specifically, but the specialty courts to do exactly what you stated, to divert people away from costly incarcerations, is pretty common. I do know that in Clallam County we have drug court, and we also have a mental health court. We don't have a specialized veterans court as of yet, and I don't know where that process is. That would be a great thing for us to have. The studies of those programs show that they are very effective in people who stick with the program in avoiding hospitalization. We've certainly seen that at PBH for people who are involved in the mental health court. They're great programs.
Are they captive?
Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that there's waiting lines for primary care in the county. Are there? What's the term to get in to see a physician or caregiver?
Well, to get into PBH for any kind of care is immediate in terms of a crisis. We have 24-hour-a-day crisis professionals who are master's-level behavioral health professionals who provide crisis counseling on the fly any time of day. To get into what people would consider to be, you know, ongoing care, we provide a screening intake to determine if somebody's eligible for services, and we can treat them within 7 days. And then they can get into the therapy process within 7 days after that. And the within 7 days, it's usually much faster than that because we have what we call walk-in Wednesdays, when we kind of take all comers and just see them as they come in. So up until September 1st, when Family Medicine becomes the North Olympic Healthcare Network, we will have been the only clinic in the county. In this part of the county, we're the only clinic in the county mandated to see people. We could not close our doors. Every other clinic could. We can't, and we're glad for that. Yes, sir.
Can you talk a little bit about depression? What are the signs that someone is depressed? How do you go about diagnosing and then treating depression?
Great question. So depression is a medical condition that's caused by a dysfunction in the way that brain cells communicate with each other. We don't know anything more specific than that, unfortunately, but we know that it's been described since humans can write. And how we describe it is based on the symptoms that people show. The symptoms that people usually show is that they have a depressed mood, sad to the point of not being able to react normally to happy stimuli for 2 weeks or more, with association with some other symptoms. Usually people have a decrease in appetite or even weight loss, although some people will go the other direction and eat more. People usually have an interruption in their normal sleep pattern. They'll either sleep less, they'll wake up much earlier than normal, won't be restful. They can be agitated, have difficulty concentrating, and then they can also start to think about what it would be like to die, or even have the thoughts that I should kill myself. So just looking at somebody passing by on the street, it's difficult to determine that. I can't do it. I need to sit down. I need to sit down with somebody for about, you know, half an hour to 40 minutes and have a good clinical examination before I can determine whether or not somebody's depressed. Whether or not somebody has major depressive disorder. I mean, sadness is part of life. Everybody gets sad. But it's when you can't get happy, when you can't get beyond that, then we say, you know what, that is your brain dysfunctioning in some regard. And there's the best part about it is once you identify it, it's very treatable. It's great. Treatments are great. The first treatment, the first thing that I tell people that they should try is they should try a course of talk therapy with a trained therapist, and they should sit down and talk it out and say what is going on, what's behind this, if anything. Sometimes there isn't anything behind it. You know you may have had your parents, brothers and sisters who all have depression, and it's just how your brain's kind of wired. And then there's lots of things that the person can do. One of the things that I tell everybody who's depressed is you have to push yourself. You're not going to want to get up and go exercise, but you have to. You have to, have to, have to, because that's how you're going to get through it. And the talk therapy is not just getting stuff off your chest. It's actually scientific evidence based on functional MRI studies that show that the actual talking helps strengthen the connections between the two sides of the brain, so that you can transfer the emotional energy. Stick with me here. Of all that kind of brain activity on the emotional side, over to the reasoning side, where you can really process it and figure things out. That helps. So talk therapy actually helps you restructure your brain a little bit. After that, you're smirking a little bit or chuckling. Yeah. Okay.
Good.
After that, one of the things that good. I'm glad you're chuckling. After that, antidepressant medications can be highly effective in a wide variety of people. Unfortunately, right now the science isn't to the point where I can do a blood test or a brain scan and say, boy, you've got depression type 36X. You should take X medication. So it's a lot of trial and error, unfortunately, there. That's where the art of medicine comes in. And then if those aren't successful, there are other, more dramatic treatments, one of which is electroconvulsive therapy, which is not like it's ever depicted in movies. It's actually an extraordinarily highly effective treatment that is actually recommended for, is one of the first line treatments for older adults who get depressed. And so there's lots of treatments for depression. It's very treatable, and it can be done in the primary care setting. Does that help?
George has another one.
George.
Yeah. We read about and hear about situations where individuals, for whatever reason, will not go to behavioral health consultation. What does one do with loved ones, family members, business colleagues, particularly if there's been a dramatic change for the worse?
Yeah. That's a great question. The first thing to do, I think, is, and I don't need to tell anybody to do this, is, continue to talk to the person about it. Be open about your concerns. Tell them what you're thinking. I think there used to be this idea that, gosh, you don't ever mention suicide to somebody because they may do it. Well, if you're that concerned about suicide, they've already thought about it. You're not putting the idea in their head, and opening that door to talk about it is helpful. So continuing to talk to them about it is the first thing to do. But I know what your real question is. It's when that has failed and they don't see they have a problem, or things are getting just really weird and you don't know what to do. So the first thing I would say is to get information. You can either talk to your primary care doctor, their primary care doctor, and just give them information. You can also call PBH and talk to one of our crisis clinicians, and they will help give you information about what the next steps are. It's very difficult to force anybody to do anything they don't want to do. And that's even true legally. In Washington State, it's extraordinarily difficult compared to other states to involuntarily hospitalize somebody. It's a legal procedure in every state, but it's much more defined by kind of the criminal defense mindset than the right to treatment mindset as it is in other states. So one of the biggest frustrations that gets expressed to us at PBH is that your designated mental health professional didn't hospitalize my loved one and they really needed to be. And we'll say, well, we agree that they should be. The law doesn't allow us to, because the law is very restrictive. Interestingly, the legislature last session, and it's just been enacted now, passed something called Joel's Law, which allows family members to directly petition the court to involuntarily hospitalize their loved one if the designated mental health professional says that there's not enough evidence for them to do that. And the standard appears to be lower for the court to go ahead and do that. We haven't had any play out in our county yet, so I'm not sure how that's going to go. Now, beyond that, there comes a point when, you know, maybe somebody has been hospitalized a couple times, or maybe it's gotten so severe that you know you're exhausted as the family member. You're exhausted as a family member. And I've had this conversation with many people, and there comes a point in time when you, as the caring family member, have to say, you know, enough's enough. I will always be here for you, but I can't be taken down by your unwillingness to do anything about your health. And I've had to have that conversation with lots of people. There comes a point, and it's usually, you know, years into the process, where I just advise people, you have to draw a line. Your health is being affected. You have to be, because if this person ever decides they do want help, you have to be healthy enough to be ready to provide that. And that's really hard. That's a really hard thing to do. But I've seen a lot of people have to do it when people really, really, really don't see or don't want help. Does that help, George?
Hey, Josh.
Yeah.
Give us 2 seconds. Alzheimer's, dementia, grief, all those things that,
well,
that's 8 years
of
study, right?
In 2 seconds?
Yeah, give it 2 seconds.
Yeah. 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 Seriously, this.
Here's how to deal with dementia in my opinion. We all will get demented if we live long enough. This is kind of a fact. So what you need to do is you need to plan for it. It really should just be part of being a responsible adult human being to plan for how you're going to deal with when you know, if you live long enough that your faculties start to decline. That means having conversations with your loved ones. That means making a plan, making sure that your durable power of attorney is intact, making sure that you're really honest with yourself early, that there may come a day that I can't think the way that I used to. The brain is an organ like any other organ. I don't know why we think that it's never going to degrade like our kidneys do, like our livers do, like our bones do. It just does. So if you live long enough, it's going to happen. There are no ways to stop Alzheimer's disease once it starts. You can't stop it before it starts either. There are medications that might help slow the loss of memory, but what it really is having a very honest conversation with your loved ones, with your children, with your spouse about, hey, here's what we're gonna do, here's how we're gonna plan for if we live long enough that this is going to start to happen to us. Is that helpful?
Good 2 minutes, John.
Okay. Hey, thank you very much for having me, guys. I really appreciate it.
He has to go to work. He just told me. Andrew, are we cool? We have no meeting. We have no meeting next Tuesday because it's the Tuesday after Labor Day. We said we weren't going to have a meeting then. And Andrew and I are organized with our schedule.